ready, will you please stand for the reading of God's word? We're in Psalm 67. May God be gracious to us and bless us, and make his face to shine upon us, that your way may be known on earth, your saving power among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Who is ready to bring him praise this morning?
See those hands up. He's changed every idol. He reigns without rival. He goes by the name of Jehovah. Speaks into night.
loved before I had a name. Washed before I knew my shame. Oh, the Lamb was slain before the earth was laid. What an awesome price he paid.
Come on, every hand lifted. We're going to give him worship.
I owe it all.
Yeah.
We worship.
Oh, what a beautiful name. Ooh, what a beautiful name.
How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God? Come on, we sing how great. You
It's not a question how great is our God? It's an exclamation. How great is our God? And the way that we know that is because we have scripture that tells us of the miraculous that he does over and over and over. And I have conversations with you guys, and I know of your stories of God doing the miraculous over and over and over. And so we can be in this building together and we can just go, how great is our God? How great is our God? And I love, we sing these songs about the name above all names. We sing Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Nissi. God has a name. He has a name because he's a person that we can know personally, not an idea. But he wants to be known and he knows us. He just wants to be let in. Because our God is a God of relationship, not a God of ideas, not a God of morals, but a God who wants to know us deeply and intimately. And so we come and we worship him, not as an idea out there, but as our Savior. The name Jesus means Savior. That's the name above all names, because I don't know about you, well, I do know about you. You and I both need to be saved. We both have things that we need to be saved from. We have a past, and even a right now, we need salvation. We need a Savior. And so we give praise to the only one who can save us. That's Jesus. And because we know how great our God is, we're able to come before him with prayer requests. And you may have come in this room this morning with a request. You might have some burden on you. You might find it difficult to sleep last night. You might have financial woes, relationship woes, all that stuff you might be bringing in here this morning going, man, I just got to step into church today. I feel like God's drawing me there. I just need to be there. Today's the day. Give it to God. So when we pray for these prayer requests, would you just have an attitude of surrender? God, would you take this? I just want to ask you to take it. Today we're praying for strength, courage, and peace for a family dealing with a sudden loss of a loved one. We're praying for healing over an uncle who's in a coma after an accident. And the prayer requests that you've brought in here, let's bring them before our great God. God, we give these requests to you. So many things I know that are on people's minds and hearts, God, that it can be so overwhelming. God, would you take our requests? Would you place them in your heart that we can know your will? Would we just submit them to you, God? Would you bring healing, provision? God, would you fight our battles for us? God, we give these things to you, knowing that your will is beautiful, perfect, and good. We pray in your name. Amen. Amen, amen. So, hey, yes, God is so good. If you are a guest here, I just want to say thanks for joining us today. I know there's a bunch of places you could have been, but you chose to be here. We have folks showing up every week. It's their first time. So if it's your first time, welcome. We're kind of crazy here, but we love it. It's a great thing to be a part of. So let's welcome our first-time guests, whether in here in A2. We're so glad that you're here today online. So good to have you. One of the things that we do around here that might be a little different, might be, I don't know, just a little weird for you, is that we celebrate praises. And we celebrate them like they're our own, like because we're part of a family, and so we celebrate stuff together. We are what we like to say, a good news church in a bad news world, right? So are you ready for some good news? Ready for some good news? All right, we have some praises. The first one, we have praise for quick healing for a granddaughter. We celebrate that, let's go! All right. We have a praise for a friend who gave their life to Christ. Let's go. And we have a praise for someone who found out they had cancer a week ago and had the tumor removed and is now cancer free. So awesome, y'all. So good. It's so good. Well, I get the distinct privilege and honor of introducing you to our speaker today. His name is Dan Lord. He pastors a church called Grace Life Chapel in St. Louis, Missouri, from the great humid Midwest. We're so excited to have him here today. And would you just welcome him? He is not just a friend, he is family. He is one of our overseers. He provides care and guidance as leaders. We are so grateful for him. And as you're taking your seats, would you just say hi to a couple people around you? There'll be an introduction video for you, but let's give up for Pastor Dan Lord.
Oh, this is some kind of awesome church. Plays, you know, a little rocky music for the guest pastor coming up today. Welcome, everybody, to God's house. I hope you've already sensed that God's presence is here. Come on, when we gather in his name, awesome things happen in our midst. I want to welcome those of you that are in auditorium number 2. What a great church that people are willing to give up the quote-unquote good seats to be in an auditorium across the lobby. That's a church that's on the move when people will willingly go and be inconvenienced. And I want to just, come on, can we give everybody in auditorium 2 a big hand today? God bless you. Thank you for joining us. In our church, we do the same thing. We leverage technology to be able to connect. And we've been leveraging technology as the church for many, many years. How many of you have read your Bible on your iPhone? We're using technology every time we do that. And so we welcome everyone over there. I bring great greetings from St. Louis, from our church family, Grace Life Chapel, and we are interconnected churches. We're not two independent churches, but our pastors and our church family, listen, we look to you guys for leadership. I've already learned a few things today I'm taking back home because we're connected. And your church family, hopefully we've been a blessing to your church. Aren't you thankful for being a part of the bigger church, the kingdom of God? Come on, we're one church in thousands of locations around the world today. Oh, that was a little charity golf clap. I can actually hear you today. Come on, aren't you thankful God put you part of a great church that's part of the global church? It's pretty awesome. And you are so blessed here as a people of God to have such great leadership team. It starts, you know, like back in the 90s, we called it the Dream Team, all Hall of Fame basketball players. This church is blessed with a dream team of pastors and leaders that help lead the people of God. You know, our pastors, Pastor Jason and Erica, their job is not to do the ministry. Their job is to equip the saints, the church, to be the church and to do the work of the ministry. So if you're new here at the Well, you need to get to Growth Track. It's starting right after this gathering in the 1 o'clock, right over in Auditorium 2. We're going to take that over to help new people connect in. And you can begin to discover your purpose. That's what this church is all about. Not the pastors being all-stars, but the pastors are more like the coaches helping all of us to become who God called us to be. So if you're new, welcome, but we're coming after you because God's got good in you that he's going to want to do through you to the world that's around you. And I'm so thankful to get to be part of this in some kind of way. Paige and I are so honored to know your pastors as friends, but to be able to be here with you has been a joy already. We've seen this weekend, last gathering, I think we had over 20 people that said yes to Jesus. In the first service, there was one. So we're in the 20s, and maybe today's going to be your day that you came to the Well seeking after a relationship with Jesus to know God. I'm going to give you that chance to pray a prayer in just a few minutes and to be able to say yes to Jesus, and your whole world is about to change. Isn't that neat that every time we gather, there's someone here that's seeking after God? That's a special responsibility that we share as the church. So welcome. We welcome all of you today. Hey, by the way, if you're joining us online, you have time to go take a shower, brush your teeth, get dressed, and come to the 1 o'clock gathering because it's going to be much better in person than it is on your little phone or computer screen. We do welcome you today, but if you can get here, if you're in the Salt Lake City region, we encourage you to get to church today. And I mentioned my family before we get into God's word. I mentioned my family. Paige and I, we've been married 27 years. We got married when we were 1 year old, so that's a pretty cool miracle. And we have 5 awesome kids. I've got a photograph of my family, and we've got great young adults now that we're raising for the Lord. And my son Graham came with me today. Would y'all welcome Graham? Make him feel some love today from the Well. We've been having a good time hanging out, being together. God's got big plans. We call him, if you see him in the lobby after church, he's Graham the Man. We gave him a little nickname, Graham the Man. So it's so fun to get to have him on this journey with me. And we're going to jump into God's word. So would you turn in your Bibles over to the book of Jeremiah chapter 6? Every time we gather, we lift up the word of God. We do that because the Bible says about itself that it is lamp, it is light to our feet, it's a light to our path. It illuminates our lives. We're going to talk about light in the message today. Another scripture in Jeremiah says that God's word is like a jackhammer and it beats up the hardness of our hearts. Sometimes we get our hearts and they get hard. They get difficult for God to mold. Anybody else with me? I can raise two hands and a foot on that one. And we need to keep our hearts soft. And so we need the preaching of God's word. There's a mystery around the preaching of the word of God. We need to hear it in our formation groups together as we're sharing. But we also need to hear the preaching of God's word and to receive it. My pastor would say to sit under the teaching of God's word. There's a mystery to it. And this church is a biblical church. This church is built on the foundation and the truth of God's word. So would you join me today? We're going to read Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 16. This is what the Lord says. Stand at the crossroads and look. Sometimes we need to slow down, not just run through the intersection, but to stand and to consider our ways, where are we headed. Pastor Howie preached a great message last week about our path. And I encourage you, if you weren't here, you should go back and watch it. It was an awesome word. He says, stand at the crossroads, look around. Ask for the ancient paths. Ask where the good way is. Some of you came today, you're seeking out this eternal ancient path, God's path, the path of the righteous. And he says, ask for the ancient paths. By the way, just a little thought there. This is not a modern church. This is an ancient church. Yeah. Maybe you came today and you're like, wow, the LED wall and the lights and all that. No, listen, this is an ancient church with new skin. There's nothing new about this church. We pray ancient prayers. We read the ancient texts. We sing according to the pattern we see in the Bible and the way they worshiped and clapped and had loud cymbals and harps and wow. We just put an amplifier to it today, right? This is an ancient church meeting in homes and throughout the week seeking the Lord together. There's nothing about the well that's new except for the building. Everything we do, we're seeking the ancient ways of God. How many know old ways work? The old ways work. So, yes, we're a newer church, but this church is built on the ancient paths. He says, ask for them and ask where the good way is. Walk in it. What happens when we walk in God's path? The scriptures promise us we will find rest for our souls. But you said, we won't walk in it. The scriptures go on and list a whole bunch of negative things that come into our lives when we choose our own path. But when we choose God's path, when we find the good way, the Bible says you'll find rest for your souls. And what I know is there's some things money can't buy. One of them's rest for your soul. Someone would say, Pastor Dan, I would like to see if money can make me happy. Oh, yeah, you can try that. How many would like? I'd like to try $1 million. I think I'll be happier. Well, you might experience some temporary happiness, but you can't find rest for your soul with the things of this world. That only comes through following Christ on these ancient paths. So today I want to speak a message entitled to you, Good News of the Good Way. Would you say that with me? Good News of the Good Way. With a little enthusiasm like you're excited. Good News of the Good Way. I love how when Pastor was up here, he said, this is a good news church in a bad news world. Well, today I've filled up with some good news from God's word about our lives, when we go down and we trust the Lord to be our leader, some of the good things that God has planned for us to come into our lives. One of the things that Paige and I have learned as parents, we learned this the hard way, is that when our children ask us, when they say, Dad, after we get done here at the zoo, can we go get ice cream? Many times as parents, we're trying to punt the no. And so we use this word, maybe. We really mean no, and we say, well, maybe we'll see how things are going once we get in the car, and we'll figure that out later. Come on, where's all my parents at today? You know what I'm, you know the power of the punt? It doesn't work. You might as well start off with, if you mean no, just say a strong, if you have no intentions to get ice cream, don't say a maybe, because our children, what I've learned about my five children is they hear a different language. A whole different conversation takes place when I tell them maybe. What they hear is, Dad just said, yes, we are getting ice cream. And not only that, we're getting 3 scoops at the most expensive place and a waffle cone, and it's going to cost Dad $8. They didn't hear maybe. They heard yes. What I know about my children is they hear yes when we say maybe. Here's the thing. You and I, when God says yes, we're hearing maybes. It's the opposite. We've grown up so much and got so much more mature in our lives and our thinking based on the world around us and the negative circumstances. We've lowered the promises of God down to our level of living and experience instead of believing like a kid that the promises of God will come true in my life. Even if it's a maybe, God meant yes. Here's what's so important. The Bible tells us unless we become like little children, we cannot even receive the kingdom of God. He said, unless you become like one of these little ones. What I know about little ones, when you ask a child to pray, they still believe that God heals. They haven't learned to not believe that God doesn't heal. And so they will pray a powerful prayer of faith for you. It'll be sweet, short, and powerful because they still believe in God. They haven't lowered their level of faith to maybe what we've experienced that we prayed one time and God didn't. And so now we've stopped believing in the promises of God that he's Jehovah Rapha, our healer. No, we need to elevate our level of faith to match who our God is. See how we do that? We bring our faith level down to our level of experience. We shouldn't do that. We should keep our faith up. He said, Pastor Dan, did you come to get our expectations up? You came here to hype us up. Yes, I did, about how good our God is and his plans and his goodness that he has for you. Yes, I came today to remind you that you're believers and not doubters.
Well, I'm kind of more of a half glass full guy.
No, you're a Christian now, and you're a half glass full kind of person. Oh, we're so good at doubting, aren't we? But what we need to do is keep our faith where it needs to be, fully in the Lord. Let me ask you, when was the last time you went to bed at night? Instead of worrying, you went to bed thinking about all God's good promises for your life. The Bible says in Psalm 119, he says, my eyes stay open through the watches of the night that I may meditate on your promises. This is one of those scriptures that when I first read it, it jumped out like a heart check. That God's like, hey, what's the speedometer look like in your heart? This is like giving you a good reading. If you're spending more nights staying up worried about the future than you are thinking about the promises of God, probably need to let God do a work on your heart when it comes to believing and trusting in him. Come on, am I speaking to anybody today? If you're spending more sleepless nights than you are going to bed in peace, then God wants you to become more like a little child to receive his goodness. I like what it says in 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 56. Praise be to the Lord. Why? He's given rest to his people Israel just as he promised. I love this little sentence. Not one word has failed of all the good promises that he gave through his servant Moses. What he's saying is, your father in heaven, your heavenly father, he keeps his promises. Maybe your earthly father, like mine, made some promises and didn't keep them. But your heavenly father's not like your earthly father. If he says it, then you can count on it that it's going to happen. And every word he says, he means. And you can trust in him. You can trust in him. So what I want us to do is, I want us to zoom in on a few promises of God. There are literally thousands of promises for you and I as God's children. But what I want us to do today is zoom in on one passage of scripture and find these five promises that I think are awesome and will leave you encouraged today. And we're going to find them from the book of Job, chapter 11. And these promises came to Job. He was being reminded in his season of great hardship. He had lost so much in his life. I can't go through and recount it all because it's so much, the grief that he had gone through. And he had a friend that was in his formation group. How many know sometimes you're at formation group, you share some of your struggles, and somebody, instead of giving you a little love, they give you a little love kick in the pants. And they're like, what you need to do is start praying more. And you're like, excuse me, I was hoping you would pray for me, right? We need a little tough love every once in a while, right? So his friend is trying to stimulate him and wake him up and remind him, if you'll do this, then God will do this. And so he had a little bit of attitude, and he gets to this part, and he gives these five promises. He reminds him of God's goodness. Verse 16, Job chapter 11. He says, you will surely forget your trouble. What a promise from God. You will surely forget your trouble, recalling it only as waters gone by. Life will be brighter than noonday. and darkness, it will become like morning. You will be secure because there is hope. You will look about you and you'll take rest in safety. You will lie down with no one to make you afraid. And many, many will court your favor. Five promises. Let's get them. First one, you will surely forget your trouble, recalling it only as waters gone by. For all the men, bullet point version, we could just say, you'll forget your trouble. You will forget your trouble. What a great gift from God. I believe of all the miracles that God does in our lives here on earth, this might be one of the greatest miracles next to our salvation. I think about prayers for healing, and I've seen God heal people. I've experienced it in my life. I've seen God provide miraculously provision for my wife and I. We know that God is faithful to take care of our needs. He watches over. I've seen all that. But one of the greatest miracles God has worked in my heart is the ability to forget the trouble that I had to go through when I was young and the heartache that was caused in my life. Some of you today, you're carrying around memories of the past. Some of it, it's a list of shame, and it's a list of regret of things that you did that you know don't please God, and that is still working in your life, and it's causing condemnation, and it's causing a wall that God decided to destroy through the work of Jesus Christ and the cross of Christ and the blood that was shed by Jesus, the Lamb of God, to take away the sin of the world. And because you're still living in that, you're allowing the enemy to terrorize your heart. And God says, I'll give you the ability, I'll give you my promise that you can forget these awful things of the past, and it'll just be like water that went by and you won't even remember it anymore. Some of you need to let God work this miracle in your life to forget those things that you did. Others of you, you're carrying around the hurt and the resentment and bitterness of a person that spoke ill to you and talked down to you and beat you up with their words. I had to go through that. Some of you, it's abuse. For others, it might be neglect, something that was wrong. Some are angry at God for things. What we need to do today is say, God, I know that got seared in my heart. Some of those memories are the hardest memories to get rid of. But God gives us this great promise that you can forget those things and you don't have to dwell on them every day. That you might be able to go a day. You might be able to start going a week. You might be able to start going a month. And a few months before, I haven't even thought about that in so long. Because God's promise for me that I can forget things. Some of us, we need to go back to the early 2000s. Take that DVD of trouble, put it back in the case, and take it back to Blockbuster and say, I'm not going to rehearse this in my mind. Some of us are just replaying the enemy's victories in our lives, in our mind. Every day, you're just going back, dwelling. No, it's time to get all that out and let God work that miracle. He says, I'll give you, I know that heart got beat up, but I'll give you a new heart. That's part of the forgetting. I love how the scriptures say that it'll be forgotten like waters that have just kind of gone by. And some of you are thinking, well, Dan, I've had so much trouble. There's a lot for me to forget. And some of you are like, that would be impossible. Others of you, you're older and you're like, forgetting's easy. That comes natural. Did you know in the Old Testament, there's 13 different words to describe this word trouble? Affliction, hardship. In the New Testament, it's basically summed up with the word suffering. We're familiar with it, aren't we? So how much more beautiful is it when we've had lots of trouble in our lives that our Father, so good, he says, I'm going to make it easier on your heart and your mind, and I'm going to wash that all the way. I think that's an amazing miracle. We don't talk about it enough. But it's available. How does it happen? It happens through the washing of the water of the Word of God. As we let God's Word renew our minds, then we're not thinking about all that anymore because God's Word washed all that hardship, all that heartache, all that oppression, all that negativity, and God will wash it out and we'll get our minds renewed. God sometimes uses other people that speak life into us, leaders and counselors and pastors and people that lead formation groups to help us get that stuff renewed and get it out of our hearts and get new hearts and new minds. Come on, somebody. It doesn't always happen overnight, but it's possible. You need to know it's possible, and you need to start believing God again that you can forget. So is this really biblical? Let me remind you, one of the most amazing things about our all-knowing God, our all-powerful God, is that there's one thing he can't remember. And that's your sins and mine when they've been forgiven by Jesus. The Bible says he takes those, and what does he do with them? He throws them into the sea of forgetfulness, never to be remembered again. See, when I was a kid, our family didn't have a lot of money. So when we went on vacations, we went to a lot of state parks. We did a lot of kind of camp out trips. And there was one little state park we'd go to. It's called the St. Francis State Park. And a little river goes through that park. It's the kind of river where it's pretty safe to play in. You know, after a big rain, it might not be so safe. But most days of the week throughout the summer, you could show up and bring your cooler food and put it on the little rocky beach. As you get closer to the river, it gets a little bit more sandy. It's not San Diego, but it's a little river in Missouri. And our parents would put their chairs kind of in the shallow part of the water where the water was going by. And we would play all kinds of games out there and play chicken. And, you know, we'd go up the river and we'd float down. We would have a blast. This was all before iPads. We were bored. And we went and had fun. One of the things we would do is we'd have boat races. We would all pick out our stick. And we would take our sticks upriver. We'd throw them in. Then we'd run down faster the river. And we would watch the sticks float by. And then next thing you know, they'd be gone. For some of you, you need to get that mental image that you need to give it to God, whatever it is you've been carrying in your mind, your heart. You need to throw it in the river of life. Did you know in heaven there's going to be a river of life? I plan to have my condo right there on the river of life. I plan to have my mansion built on the sea of forgetfulness where the Lord Jesus washed it all away and I watched it go. And then I'm going to get to the sea and be like, well, this is a great view. Don't forget, or I should say remember, that our God's good at forgetting, so much so he's built a lake, an ocean, a sea called the Sea of Forgetfulness. This might be the one thing that you need to be reminded of. I know I've got four more promises, but I'm sitting on this today because I believe this is one of the biggest things we need God's help with, is to help us move on into our future. Amen? You'll recall it just like that little stick going by. It'll be gone. It'll be just a forgotten memory. Second promise from God. He says, life will be brighter than noonday, and darkness will become like morning. Second promise is your life will be brighter. Your life can actually be brighter. Somebody came into the auditoriums today, and you'd say, Pastor Dan, if I'm honest, my life is filled with nothing but darkness around me. I want you to know things are about to change because you're going to put your trust in Jesus, and the light of God is going to begin to shine in. He's going to open up the windows, and the light's coming in to fill the whole room. It doesn't take much light to change a room, does it? No, your life will be brighter. I love what Psalm 18, verse 28 says, you, Lord, you keep my lamp burning. Come on, he's our oil in our lamp. My God turns my darkness into light. Good news is, the darker it is, the brighter God can make it, because he can take all that darkness and turn it into light. Say, can he really do it? Yeah. Let me remind you another attribute of our God, what he does for us. This is the same God that the scriptures say he gives us beauty for ashes. Okay, what are ashes? Real deep Bible study we're having today. What did you learn at church about ashes? What are ashes? Ashes are when you take something and you burn it and there's actually nothing left. You have nothing left to work with when it's a pile of ashes. Right. Let's say if you ask me, Dan, can you build a set of lawn chairs for the back porch out of this pile of 2x4s? I'd say, sure. But if you burn up all the wood and then say, can you build anything good out of this? I'd have to say, no, it's not possible anymore. How many know that's a miracle when God can come along and take the pile of ashes and still build something useful of our lives? In the same way he does that miracle, he also brings light where there is no light. Some of you don't know what to do next. It's darkness. You're stumbling. You're tripping over things. You can't seem to find your footing in life. I want you to know, you need to let God turn the light on. You need to start saying, Lord, thank you. You're a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. God, you will show me my very next step. You said that the righteous will not stumble and fall, that if we follow you, you're a good shepherd, and you don't lead us over mountain and hill and the stony places, but you lead me into good places, and I can trust where you lead me. So God, show me the next step, and God will shine the light. He doesn't always shine the light all the way down the path, but he shows us the next step. Aren't you thankful he turns the lights on for us? Psalm 112, the psalmist says in verse 4, even in darkness, light dawns for the upright, for those who are gracious, compassionate, and righteous. Notice this isn't, again, for anyone. This is on the ancient path for those that are following after Christ, letting Jesus be the leader of their life. For those, I love how he puts this, for those who are gracious, compassionate, and righteous. If you need a little more light, try giving it to some other people through being gracious, compassionate, and be living according to the word of God. And guess what will happen? The lights will be brighter in your life. There's a morning scripture in the Bible about light. It says that the path of the righteous is like the first gleam of the morning sun. That's for all the people that go to the 8:30 service. Right? They saw the sunrise today, you know? Is there anybody that's a morning person here in this gathering today? Wow, God bless you all. Thanks for coming late to see us. Now, I'm not a morning person. I really wake up about right now. I mean, I can be awake physically. Anybody else there? I'm awake at 8:30, 9, 10, but it's like now I'm really awake. This Bible verse tells us that the path of the righteous is like that sunrise moment. I see it occasionally when I have an early morning flight and I'm driving to the airport and I'm like, oh, so this is why people like to get up early. And it's as beautiful as a sunset. How many of you know what I'm talking about, my non-morning people? Every once in a while you catch a sunrise and think, this is amazing. God gives us that mental picture that's what our whole lives will be like if we follow him, that the path of the righteous isn't dark. It's like the first gleam of the morning sun, and you're like kind of awestruck at 5:30 in the morning, like, wow. That's the mental picture God wants you to have about your future, that my path is bright. My path is beautiful. This is going to be a beautiful day today because the Lord is shining on my path. Aren't you thankful he lights up our life? He shines his light into our darkness. Third promise, he says, you will be secure because there is hope. So we could simply say, you will be secure. Notice he says, because there's hope. Sometimes we put our trust and our hope in the wrong places, and we expect security in our lives, in our hearts. We become fools. We get fooled by the enemy. I know not you. That was everyone in the early gatherings today. No fools here, but if we were really to be honest, we get fooled into worldly thinking we'll find security in other things besides the Lord and his word. Bad news. You can have all the money in the bank account and think when I hit this certain number, I'll feel secure. You'll get that number in the bank account and you won't feel any more secure, because the Bible doesn't say you will be secure when you hit a certain number in the bank account. It says you will be secure because there's a hope. When you have a hope, hope has a name. His name is Jesus. When you have a hope, then you can have security in your life. Doesn't matter how much. Now, it helps to have a certain number in the bank account, but you won't find real hope. You won't find real security until your hope is in the Lord. Come on, are y'all tracking with me today? Sometimes we get fooled. We get this foolish thinking, and it's stinking thinking. We need to let the Lord clean that out of our heart. I have two older brothers. I have two older brothers. And when we were young, my oldest brother, he was ornery. He would pick on me a lot. And one time he had a paper towel, came up to me. He put it right up to my lip and he said, stick your tongue out. And I foolishly stuck my tongue out. He promptly grabbed my tongue and yanked it. I was sore for, he's evil older brother, right? You know, he would do these kind of things to me. Sometimes when I was real young, I would have all my money out of my piggy bank and I'd be counting it and adding it all, you know, stacking it and organizing pennies and all that. And he would come over and make trades with me. And he'd say, see this big nickel? I'll trade it for those little bitty dimes. Look, it's bigger than the dimes. How many know I was a fool for a little while until I figured out I was getting robbed? Some of us are letting the devil, the enemy, rob us and fool us into thinking that if we put our hope in these other things, somehow we'll find security in our hearts, and all we're doing is letting the devil yank our tongue and steal our stuff. And it's time we wake up and realize, no, I will have security, not because of earthly things, but because I know where I've built my house. I've built it on the solid rock of Jesus. I know that I have a bright hope, like Pastor Dan preached about. I know that God's shining on my life, and he's going to take care of my next steps. My hope isn't here. My hope is in Jesus. My hope is in eternal things. My hope is in heaven. My hope is in his promises. And if I have that, then I have security in my heart. Is this making sense to you today? I sure hope it is today. You will be secure because there is hope. We need to stop making that bad trade. Fourth promise we see in the Word of God. He says, you will look about you. You will look about you and you'll take your rest in safety. We could simply say you will rest in safety. I know for me, when I'm in a new place, if I go to a new city or especially international travel, or if I'm in a rough part of town and I haven't been there before, I'm like on hyper alert. I'm like, woo, Karate Kid, little mix of Navy SEAL. Don't mess with Dan if I'm unsure about my surroundings. My head's on swivel. I'm checking people out. Come on, how many of you are like that? Okay, what's wrong with the rest of y'all? You need to wake up when you're somewhere unfamiliar. You should check things out a little bit more, especially if our kids are around. Man, I'm like, you know, it could even just be a parking lot. I'm like, unfamiliar with this part. I'm like, get over here by that. Stay over here by the cars. I'm a little bit more nervous when I'm in unfamiliar territory. But what the scripture says is you'll be able to look around you and you'll be able to chill out. Why? Because someone else is taking care of you. You're in a safe place now. You've been led to the green pastures and you've been led to the quiet waters, and you don't have to be in, you know, stranger danger mode. You can take a breath and you can relax. Notice it says that you'll rest in safety. I love it how Leviticus chapter 26, verse 6 says, I will grant peace in the land and you will lie down and no one will make you afraid. You will lie down in green pastures. When you lie down, that's the most vulnerable position you can be in as a human. It's neither defensive or offensive position. You're just vulnerable for attack. But it's also the position we find the most rest for our physical bodies in. Your heart doesn't have to work as hard to pump the blood. Your body gets to relax. All your muscles get to relax. Spiritually, some of you're not getting the spiritual rest you need because you're not trusting in his promise that this is a good time to go ahead and relax and lay down. You need to receive that your King, he cares more about you than he does building his kingdom. He's not built a kingdom for himself. He built a kingdom for you. You have a heavenly Father that's building you a home in heaven. He sent his son Jesus to love you and care for you. He created the well. He put it in your pastor's heart to move here knowing no one, to start a life-giving church so that you could find a place where you could lay down and find rest for your soul. What a gift from God. Psalm 29, verse 11 says, the Lord gives strength to his people, and the Lord blesses his people with peace. Sometimes people will ask me, Pastor Dan, will you pray for me? Pray for peace in my heart. Just really troubled right now. Going through some things, and I look back at them, and I'm a mean pastor, and I say, you know what? Thanks for asking me to pray for you, but I don't pray for peace for people. Because Jesus said, my peace I give to you. And I don't give you my peace like the world gives. I don't give it and take it away. My peace isn't temporary like the world's peace. I give it to you. My peace is eternal. So I don't pray for people for peace. And I'll say to them, I'll say, you know what? I want to encourage you. Go back in your mind. Go back in your mind's eye to the place you gave up your peace. Go back in your mind to the place someone robbed you of your peace and go get it back. Was it in the doctor's office? Was it when you got that phone call? Was it when you looked at your bank account? Was it when you lost your job? Wherever you lost it, wherever you gave it up, I want to encourage you today. Our God is the God who says, I will bless my people with peace. He's already given it to you. The world might have taken it away or you might have lost it. Let's go get it back. Why? Because the Bible tells us in the New Testament that the peace of God, which passes understanding, it will do what? It will guard your heart. I mean, we need our hearts guarded, and your mind. My thought life needs to be guarded. My spiritual, the heart that contains the spirit man, the spirit woman that lives forever, it needs to be guarded. And peace itself is like a good guard dog for you. That when you lose your peace, that's just a warning. Warf, warf, warf. You better get it back, Dan. How many know we've gotten too casual with our peace? God's given you a gift of peace. He's blessed his people with peace. We need to learn to walk in that peace. Come on, not let so many people rob us of that peace so easily. And then the last promise today, he says many, many, not a few, not a couple, but many people will court your favor. We could say like this, you will live a life of influence. You could live a life of influence if you believe in the promises of God. A lot of us, we're waiting for someone else to bless us. We're hoping someone else will open a door for us when God wants to flip that whole thing. And he's like, I actually want you to be the one that people are coming to for you to open a door for them. Can we graduate from hoping for favor to begin walking in God's favor because what he's already done for us, that we are now co-heirs with Christ Jesus and everything that God the Father promised the Son died on a cross, gave his life, overcame death, hell, and the grave, so you and I could now walk as confident believers and we can walk as co-heirs with Christ Jesus. And now we become not just the receivers, but the blessers. Oh, I'm hoping that y'all will graduate up into kingdom thinking of how God sees you. You're supposed to be the one not with your hand out, but with your hand out this way, extending, doing the blessing. You're the one not supposed to be asking for the handout, but giving the handout. You're the one that's causing someone to have a job, not hoping you'll get a job. Trying to encourage you today. It's time to graduate into the promises of God, that God wants you to be the blessing. This year for my church family, this is what I've been sitting on. I felt like going into this year, God told me, I want my people to understand the favor that is on their life, Dan. I've placed it on them. I have filled them with my Holy Spirit. And I want it coming out of them to be the blesser of the world around them. Maybe you've been unaware of just how much favor you already have with God. You don't have to beg God for anything. If he gave you Christ Jesus, how will he not already give you everything else you have need of? The answer is, he did the hard part. He won't hold anything else that's good for our lives back from us. If he already made the ultimate sacrifice, anything else he's giving us, that's easy for him because he already gave us Jesus. Come on, you have Jesus already in you. You have God on your side. He's fighting your battles for you. You're a king's kid. Let's act like it, and let's start letting God flow through us to be a blessing. Come on, somebody. Living a life of influence like he told Abraham, through you I will bless all the nations of the earth. Through you. God wants to do it. His promises are true. They're for each and every one of us. I'd like for us in both auditoriums in this holy moment just to quietly put our things aside and let God begin to work and do a little more work. I believe he's already been working. Would you just put your things aside today? And would you just stand and bow your head before the Lord today? Thank you for your obedience and following the Lord. Would you just bow before him, the King of Kings, our Heavenly Father? I believe God wanted me today to bless you and to speak his words of life over you. Some people, it's that first promise, the forgetting of the trouble, the forgetting of the hardship, the heartache. Others, it's things are dark and you need the light. Some of us, it's the safety and security and the peace. For others, it's favor. You need to see yourself the way that God sees you. So would you just open your hands to God? And if the Lord's dealing with your heart in one of these promises, and he's like, I'm trying to download my promises. Just would you open up to receive? Father, in the name of Jesus, we come to you boldly to the throne of grace with confidence, knowing, Lord, that you have nothing but good intentions for us, your children. We've come today to receive, to grow in our faith, in our trust in you. Lord, help us in our unbelief when we don't believe. Father, today I pray for those that are dealing with that forgetting, that you would help them start a process today, Lord, of healing and mending that broken heart and to begin changing the memory bank of our hearts and minds. What's been seared there, Lord, erase that. Put that new heart in there, a new heart of flesh, Lord.
thank you, God, that you walk with us. It's not overnight, but you need to begin believing the promise of God. I'm gonna forget about this. Why don't you just make that declaration just softly before the Lord? Lord, I'm gonna forget about that. I'm gonna forget about that in Jesus' name. Father, we pray for those that seem as dark days. We thank you that your word is speaking and that you're using people to speak light and life through our foundation groups, our pastors, leaders. Lord, we thank you for clear words of understanding and knowledge what the next step would be. Shine your light, we pray. Lord, I bless your people with the light of God. Lord, those that need security, may they find it only in putting their trust in you. May they find real hope in you, Lord Jesus, today. Those that need rest for their souls, Lord, tonight, may they find that even physically in their sleep, that worry has to go, and that tonight as they lay their head on their pillow, they'll think about your promises and they'll have peace, not because of a pill, not because of a drink, not because everything in this world is right, but because of your promises, God. And Lord, we thank you for your favor. May it be evident in your people. May this week, God, you cause us to find opportunity to be the blessing instead of the one receiving the blessing, God. Lord, we bless you. We thank you. Come on, can we just thank the Lord? Lord, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your watchful eye. God, we know you're not far from any of us today. If we could just stay in this holy moment, special moment today. Maybe today you came seeking after Jesus. You say, Dan, if I'm honest, I know I have a past I'm not proud of. I need forgiveness for my sin. Dan, my future, it doesn't look bright. I'm in charge of my future, and I can't get it. I need to trust God with my future. Dan, if I were to die today, I know I'd go to hell and be lost forever. I need to accept Christ. If that's you, God has a better plan. He wants you to put your trust in him. The Bible says if you just have a little bit of faith, a little bit of faith, you can see mountains move. Those are mountains of shame or regret or sin or bitterness, whatever it might be. And he'll move that so you can know Jesus. And you're already hearing his voice right now saying, come to me. I've done the hard part. Why don't you come trust me? So I'm going to lead us in a simple but powerful prayer. If you'd like to be included today, I'm going to ask you to do one bold thing. And that's reach up a hand to God. That's it. Hands are already going up. Reach up a hand to God, and God will see what you're doing with your hand. He'll know what's happening in your heart. That's it. With some boldness today, I see many hands in this room. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, just in the right section alone. There in the other auditorium, that's it. With some boldness, raise your hand. Many more people raising their hands. Thank you, Lord. You can go ahead and put those hands down. And church family, I want to invite you to pray this simple prayer with me. And pray with those that have lifted their hands so that they don't feel alone today. Say from your heart today. Put a little volume to your faith. Say, dear Jesus, I invite you into my heart today. I want to know you. Help me to hear your voice and to follow you, Jesus. I repent of my sin and I turn to you today. Thank you for giving me hope, for giving me eternal life and a bright future here on earth. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen, church. Come on, can we go wild today?
Yeah.
All these that have gotten saved, yeah. God bless you today.
Wow. For those of you that said yes, we just want to celebrate with you. Such a beautiful thing to say yes. You know, as Pastor Dan was saying, that step of faith is just that next step. It doesn't have to be monumental. It doesn't have to be huge and massive. But this is a turning point for those of you that have said yes. The next step in your faith. And what we want to do is encourage you for whatever the next step after that is. And so we have our next step tables in the lobby outside. I want to encourage you, if you said yes today, would you stop by and let somebody at one of those tables know? They want to put a Bible in your hand. They want to put a book in your hand. They want to pray for you. They want to encourage you and help you with this journey now that you are on. Because it's not something that should be done by yourself, alone. I mean, we want you to know where to start and what to do next. So we want to put those tools in your hand. And likewise, if you're a first-time guest, we'd love to just meet you. Stop by, say hello. Let us know that you're new, that you would love to connect or get to know somebody or anything like that. If you do that, we'll make a donation to some organizations that we have in your name. And we'd love to just get to know who you are and help you get connected around here. And if this is a place that you call home, It's your family, and you give of your tithes and offerings in this place. The way to do that is behind us. We are so thankful that you're on mission with us to reach this valley for Jesus. It is a beautiful thing that we are able to participate with God in. And just a couple of announcements before we dismiss today. If you participated in Serve Day last year, could you just raise your hand? Were you part of Serve Day last September? A handful of you in here. Well, we had 450 people help out with over 20 projects throughout the city and the valley around here. And our next Serve Day is coming up. It's September 7th. And if you haven't been part of it, we're going to show a quick video here so you can see what it is that a Serve Day is about. So, hey, sign up. Registrations are already open. There's people signing up already. It's a blast, you guys. We get to be the hands and feet of Jesus to the community around us. And so it's just so much fun to do together. I know you have come in here this morning, or we're in afternoon now, but you may have brought something in with you that you just would like prayer for. We'll have folks up on either side of the stage that would love to pray for you. So come on up. They would love to pray for whatever needs, requests that you have. And just bring that to God for you. You might not have the words. And so come on up, and they would love to do that. And then, as has become our tradition, we give a benediction. It's just a blessing as you go out. And so to follow the pattern of Pastor Dan's blessing, can I just send you out with a blessing today? Church, may you forget your troubles. May the darkness be made bright. May you have hope and security in Jesus. May you walk in the peace given to you. And may you go out from here being a blessing to others, sharing the goodness and greatness of God. Amen? Amen, church. We love you. Thank you. Have a great week. We'll see you next Sunday.